Welcome back to Mechanical Pros. I'm John, I'm here with Quentin, and we're gonna be digging into how to diagnose and check the resistance of powerheads on VRV. Daikin VRV 4 powerhead resistance checks. How do you diagnose an expansion valve powerhead for VRV, Quentin?
Yeah, so there's a few things that you wanna look at whenever you're first coming up on a VRV, whether it be a VRV 3, VRV 4, whatever it is that you might have, especially if it's a brand new site. So we have a few different types of these EEVs. We have the clip-on style,
Okay. Which
essentially just pops on top of
the bowl. So that one just sits on top of the expansion valve.
You just push it down, twist it, and it snaps into place.
Yeah.
It's got a couple little divots there.
How do you know if it's actually seated properly?
Oh, you'll know.
Oh, yeah.
You'll pop it down and you'll feel it twist.
Yeah.
So you don't want to have any space in between that little rail on the top and the actual bulb that's going to fit up inside of there. Okay, so you're going to push it down, snap it into place. There'll be a couple little divots on that valve body.
Okay.
And so you'll feel it whenever it's nice and snug. So the problem with these EEVs that we most commonly see is they're not serviced. They're not maintenance properly.
Okay.
These actually have to be popped off and cleaned. Okay, so these reside primarily.
And most people probably don't know that, right?
Yeah, it's a little known fact.
Okay.
But it's something that's very critical, because if you have one of these that stays dirty, it can result in a whole host of issues, albeit refrigerant flood back, kill compressors, things such as that.
I mean, that's really controlling all your refrigerant flow.
Sure. Yeah, that thing's full of EEV. So any given VRV might have anywhere from 3 to 7 electronic expansion valves in it. The most important thing to note about this style is it must be cleaned. All right, these reside in the outdoor units most commonly. All you have to do to take it off is just simply twist it. It might be a little tight at first, especially if it's rusty under there. Rust is a problem on these.
Okay.
We want to pop it off of there. If there's any rust inside of this, you're going to want to clean it.
Okay.
I like to use Scotch-Brite. Sometimes a pipe fitting brush can go in there, battery terminal brush, whatever you can fit in there to clean it up.
Gotcha.
The actual valve body itself that looks like a little silver bulb, same thing there. Scotch-Brite, twist it around, clean it up. So whenever rust builds up inside of this EEV, it can no longer control properly. So basically, the board can be sending a command to the EEV, but you know the EV doesn't respond. It's kind of a lost cause there. These are also found in just a handful of the indoor units.
What kind of error code do you think that would throw?
Well,
or would you even tell?
Sometimes you might not get an error code. On the newest variations of the VRV, VRV 4, VRVX, we have an F4 error code that could present itself, you know, like a refrigerant flood back fault. But on a VRV 3, most of the time you're not going to get that error code.
Okay.
So this is a definitive maintenance item that needs to be taken care of. Every time that you touch one of these, I like to go ahead and pop them off, check them, make sure that it's clean. If it's not clean, it's a good time to go ahead and clean it. It takes just a few seconds.
So those you're popping off, you're hitting it with a wire brush, making sure all your contacts are rust-free.
That's right.
And putting it back on.
Putting it back on.
Okay.
So one thing I would like to note, whenever you're doing any type of EEV inspection or work, put that system into forced recovery mode. That way you kind of have a starting point.
Okay.
What's you don't want to. Basically, it opens up all of the refrigerant valves within the system.
Okay.
Okay, so that way the system's not operational when you're popping this thing off. That way it's not trying to drive the EEV while it's off.
So you're just doing a real a test and open everything wide open.
And then
seeing how everything responds.
Yeah, absolutely. Okay. Absolutely. So the next type that we have is the bolt-on style.
Okay.
And this is most commonly found on VRV3 outdoor units. And this is on pretty much every indoor unit,
Okay. This
bolt-on style. What I like to do during maintenance of the outdoor units, take this thing off of there, inspect it for cracks right through here. If you see any kind of cracks or anything like that in this black plastic, this thing's got to be replaced. It's lived out its life.
So this one's obviously exterior mount. It's basically a snap-on. Mm-hmm. That is bolt-on. Am I getting into the refrigerant circuit there?
That's actually a great question.
Yeah.
So you just unbolt this thing, no refrigerants lost.
Okay.
It's all completely encapsulated.
Okay.
I could see myself being hesitant to pull that off,
thinking
I'm going to lose charge.
Absolutely.
Yeah.
Absolutely. So you just unbolt this, and basically you'll see like a little gear in there. All right.
Okay.
It's almost like a threaded rod, perhaps.
Mm-hmm.
So whenever this thing pushes out, whenever this valve gets a command to go closed, it's driving that little pin out.
Okay.
And it's pushing down on the spring actuated valve.
All right.
And so if this little stem is fully out, then it should be fully closed. So something to note, if you unbolt this from the valve body is now essentially full open.
Okay.
Because there's nothing to resist against it.
That's right.
To push down on.
That's right. So with that being said, Sometimes these things, after years of use, maybe you know, we sit commonly on, you know, 10-year plus VRV3 systems.
Is that what we got over here?
That's exactly what we have there.
Oh, man.
So once moisture starts to get inside of these things, if these things crack, they start to get moisture inside of them, and that moisture binds these gears up. So this is a failed one. And you notice the stem is completely out on this one. Okay. So this position would be the valve fully closed. So this particular instance, the coil was no longer flowing in your refrigerant.
So here the stem is somewhat, what do you call that all the way
fully
in?
That's fully retracted.
Okay, it's fully retracted, and then that's fully extended.
So in this position, you're probably not flowing any refrigerant at all. So if this is on an indoor unit, the heat exchanger on that indoor unit is likely not active
at
all.
Can I see that thing? I want to look at the gears and what that thing actually looks like on the backside. And so these are what we need to make sure that, well, you would never open this up.
Yeah, but, so this is a sealed head.
Okay.
But this is just, we decided to pop that one apart and just see what was going on after the fact. This was diagnosed as defective. So whenever we could actually feel this one trying to drive and the stem wasn't moving.
Okay.
So you'll feel that little thing kind of rocking a little bit and you can watch it and the stem won't move at all.
So what's the actual maintenance on this, if there is any?
On this one, for the outdoor units, it's mostly just inspection. Okay.
Okay.
You're popping it off, you're looking for cracks, things such as that. You're looking to make sure that when the system is in forced recovery mode, this stem should be fully retracted, almost flush with this EEV head. If you pull this thing off, you've got the system already in forced recovery mode. You wait a few minutes, go get you a cup of coffee, whatever it is that you're going to do.
Okay.
And you come back and you pull it off and it looks like that, there's probably a problem with that EEV head because that stem's still fully sticking out.
Okay.
It should be wide open at that point. So at that point, you could probably go ahead and say that this is going to be a defective EEV head because this could still pass the winding resistance check, but it might be mechanically jammed up, which was the case with this one.
Yeah.
Notice all that corrosion and rust in there. These gears can't turn anymore.
Okay. Yeah, I think it's pretty safe to say this one's done.
Yeah, that one's toast.
All right.
So with there being different types of EEVs, you're going to have to reference the service manual for each one. They're going to have different winding resistances and things such as that. These things reside in outdoor units, indoor units,
so
branch selector boxes.
You keep your service manual closed.
Oh, absolutely.
Yeah.
Absolutely. I've got hard copies of all of these things.
You don't have that thing memorized yet?
Not quite. There's quite a few pages in that one. Yeah. So I haven't committed it to memory quite yet. But one of these days before I retire, I might get there.
And that's what I love. I mean, Quentin is a student of this, and he goes through and he makes his notes and he studies this stuff.
I mean, look at the tabs on that thing.
So very cool.
So we're going to check out one of the five-wire EEVs. Like I said earlier, this is something that you might find like a subcooling heat exchanger at your outdoor unit. This same snap-on style, it might physically look a little bit different, but it's going to be the same style on the VRV4. All of the EEVs in the VRV4 condenser are going to look like this. The bolt-on style only resides in the indoor units and then the VRV3 and earlier vintage stuff outdoor units. So the first thing you're going to want to do is get your meter. You want to make sure that you have a trustworthy meter. You're going to set it to resistance.
Do you trust your meter?
Oh, I do trust this one. This one's brand new. Yeah. It's a Fluke 179. I'm pretty pleased with it so far.
You want to set it? I got meter envy.
You should.
Yeah, it's pretty awesome.
Can't say that I blame you. So you're going to want to get yourself a set of skinny meter leads because the traditional meter leads are not going to fit in these tiny little terminals. Okay, so you're going to figure out which one of these is your common. So generally, the common wire is going to be out here all by its lonesome, all out here by itself.
Okay.
Once again, reference that service manual because we're all going to learn something. Anytime you open it up, you're going to figure something else new out. Okay. So we're going to take 1 meter lead. We're going to go to gray. Let's go ahead and stick it in this terminal right here. See if I can just hold it in place there. We're going to check the black winding first. We have 47 ohms. We're going to go to our next wire. We have 47 ohms. The next wire, 47 ohms. And then the final wire, we have 47 ohms. So with all of those being balanced, we can go ahead and assume that the windings in this particular EEV head is still intact.
And that fires you up. You get pretty excited about
that. Oh, man, I'm pumped about it.
Yeah.
I love it. That's what I like to see.
All right, so tell me your biggest frustration of trying to troubleshoot a power head on a Daikin VRV expansion valve.
Well, you know, my biggest frustration a lot of times is just getting this EEV head off of the actual valve body, because these things go for years without maintenance. And for whatever reason, somebody has told everybody that this stuff doesn't require maintenance. Minimal maintenance, but it does require some maintenance. Yeah. You've got to pop these things off and clean them, okay? And if they haven't ever been cleaned and it's 10 years old, you're going to have a hard time getting that thing off without twisting up some copper pipe.
Yeah.
So that's probably the most frustrating part about any of it. As far as the indoor units, the EEV head getting stuck, whether it be open or closed, unless you're getting a comfort complaint, that's something you're probably going to have to discover on service checker, or you may be able to go up to the NavStat and read the temperature sensor values as part of your maintenance procedure and just see, you know, how this thing's performing.
Cool. The snap-on design seems like that's much more friendly from a field standpoint.
Yeah, it's not bad. It's not bad. And, you know, generally we don't really see a ton of winding failures on these motors. It's generally just these things are subjected to the elements. You know, so it's generally stuff like that, whether it be the cracking of the plastic on this one or the rust buildup on this one. And, you know, the same thing with the indoor units. These things are bolted right on the end of the indoor heat exchanger, so they have a lot of moisture surrounding them.
So you said, you know, you could have half a dozen or so electronic expansion valves and they on a Daikin system.
Oh, and one outdoor unit.
And so what's one bad expansion valve going to do?
Well, depending on which expansion valve it is, it could result in refrigerant floodback. That's our most common issue.
Okay.
Especially if the subcooling circuit is stuck in the open position, then you're flooding liquid refrigerant right back to the compressor there. If you have a...
You're probably going to trash your compressor eventually.
Oh, yeah, very quickly. Yeah. And so that's a really common one that gets overlooked. You know, compressor failure is generally a symptom of something else. Mm-hmm. These compressors are very robust. If you have compressor failures, you need to figure out what's going on with it. And most of the time, it leads back to an older system just having an EEV that hasn't been looked into.
Yeah. VRV is an awesome technology. You just got to figure it out.
That's right.
Right?
Yeah.
And we're learning it every day. All right, so that's how to diagnose a power head on a Daikin VRV unit. Hit that like, hit that subscribe, and we'll see you next time.